Time for the Urban Magazine. You're welcome to this week's edition. My name is Barbara Nyamweza. This week, we look at how the Uganda Communications Commission has set out an operation to make sure that all our mobile phones in the country are authentic. Now, have you ever realized that your phone has a number called the International Mobile Equipment Identity Number that should make sure that you are on air? The mobile phones without this number, that is the Authentic International Mobile Equipment Identity Number, will soon be disconnected. This week, UCC, which is the body that governs communication in Uganda, has finalized plans to have all the mobile phones that do not have this number switched off, and these account to about 2 million in the country. They also include other devices that are laptops and other smart devices on the market in Uganda. Simon Semazi has the details of this story.
This is a situation that's going to happen in a few months' time following Uganda Communications Commission's move to switch off what are called fake phones on the market. Retina Mwebaza is a businesswoman dealing in house painting, a job she has had for almost 3 years. She reveals that she can't perform what she does best if the government continues with its move of switching off fake phones. For one to get to know an original mobile phone, there are procedures to be followed. Type *#06#. However, to some mobile phones, this does not work.
I suggest a way to switch off the phones because I personally, I use online marketing. So when they switch off the phones, I'll be affected as a person and as a company, because as the Texture Paint and Designs Uganda Limited company, we use online marketing. So when the phones are off, most of our marketing, since it's online, on WhatsApp, Facebook, and we have different pages, we may be affected. And we don't know whether our customers have original phones or fake phones. So I think it will affect.
Although this one has not worked out for Mwebaza, according to UCC, by dialing *#06#, a 15-digit code will be displayed on your phone screen for each line you have. If the phone has the provision for two SIM cards, you will see two 15-digit codes, which is called an International Mobile Equipment Identity Code. Enter the 15-digit International Mobile Equipment Identity Code in the box provided on UCC's website and press Verify My Phone, and the model manufacturer and frequency of the phone bands and of the phone corresponding with the IMEI code will be displayed for you to compare and verify a match. This can be obtained from the UCC website. According to UCC, about 2 million mobile phones and laptops will soon be switched off, a move which has caught the attention of phone users and dealers. Mark Blessed, a mobile phone dealer in downtown Kampala, notes that many people make ends meet from dealing in such mobile phones, adding that the pandemic has affected people and they won't be able to raise money for the original phones, which are sold at a high cost.
Unlike for the people who deal in fake phones, it's quite challenging because this is where they get their money to sustain them. But due to the fact that the UCC is planning to cut off the phones, the fake phones, I see the reasons. It's quite challenging, get it, for the market, because you know people don't have money right now at the moment, you know, and these fake phones, they say fake phones are the phones which are like cheap and which are affordable, unless they have a way.
Fake phones are those phones which are counterfeit. These are cheap phones, meaning that being cheap, they are made up of cheap material. They don't take into consideration the health effects of phones. And of course, they have to make them cheap so that they can compete with the original phones. And therefore, so many things will be missing which are likely to affect the health of any person using the phone.
The discussion about the switch-off is one that has been persistent as more and more deadlines are set but never met with logistical and legislative hurdles being cited as the obstacles. UCC and telecom operators will deactivate phones whose specifications fall short of minimum standards and phones without authentic international mobile equipment identity. UCC stresses that the Central Equipment Identity Registry System has been installed and tested to crack down fake phones on the market. Mark Blessed, a mobile phone dealer, states that minus the use of the machine, he is able to detect between a fake and genuine mobile phone.
It is very, very visible. Like, because I've been dealing in business, this kind of business, for quite a long time. For the fake phones, it is visibly, I mean, you can easily see it, like the phone is not really genuine. Like the battery, it can also have some problems heating up. It can also have some issues about the network. You know, someone deciding to get a phone like that, I believe they have their own what reasons. But I wouldn't say that someone would like to have a fake phone, just because of what? The condition.
Retina Mwebaza notes that if such a move is enacted, she will automatically be forced to run out of business, hence calling for the concerned regulatory bodies to carry out mass sensitization before the move is made.
Personally, I was suggesting the first way to switch off the phones, because many people don't know the difference between fake and original. So I was suggesting they wait and sensitize the people about fake and original phones. That is, they should first give it some time so that some people learn about the difference between fake and original.
On many occasions, the government's body in charge of formulating and promoting the use of standards has been grilled because of its failure to fight counterfeit products on the market, something which has left Mwebaza puzzled.
I want to ask myself from the UNBS body why phones are going to be switched off, since it's their role to check the fake and original phones. And again, a person injecting in 300, 1 million to buy a phone, it will affect the end user, since it is their job to verify the fake and original phones. So I'm asking, were they bribed, or they would have checked the original and fake phones so that such circumstances of switching off their phones are off the body right now?
Sylvia Chirabo, the head of marketing and public relations at Uganda National Bureau of Standards, notes that they are working hand in hand with the different government bodies in the fight against fake goods on the market. Chirabo adds that standards for the different products are being developed with consultations with the concerned parties, adding that they are doing their best to reach out to the public on the dangers of using fake products.
We make the standards, but we know in the standardization work, you cannot work alone. We have different government bodies. We have different regulators with whom we work together to enforce standards. For example, we have the National Drug Authority. They enforce the standards for the drugs or any medicinal products on the market. So it's the same way UCC is doing for the phones. It is within their mandate as regulators for the telecommunication sector. So with Ghana National Bureau of Standards, there is no problem with that.
Owen Hamza Kadu, a dealer in mobile phones, noted that fake mobile phones are being sourced from China. He called on the government to pull up their stockings on this matter.
Our societies, the income, people get less money. You get a phone of 1 million. Some people can't afford. You get. That's why the Chinese got that issue and brought fake phones so that people can manage to get phone.
But what could be the health effects of using fake phones? Dr. Vincent Karuhanga reveals that some of the diseases people suffer from are being caused by the use of fake phones.
It's very well known that many Ugandans charge their phones in their bedrooms. At night when they are sleeping, they leave on these phones. and the light that is emitted can disturb one's sleep. And this is why the light is limited when the phone is not fake. But for the fake phones, the light is not limited, and especially the blue light is likely to disrupt sleep. And many people will complain of headaches in the morning after not having had a very nice sleep. And some of them will even be quarrelsome just because they have not had a good night's sleep.
Almost 80% of people use smartphones, and according to Mark Blessed, when fake phones are switched off, many will be forced to turn back to using button phones because most of the fake phones are actually smartphones.
Encouraging the Ugandans to develop a quality culture, to demand for quality. If you're not sure about what you're going to buy, don't buy it. If that product does not have a UNBS quality mark, don't buy it. Two, if you know someone who is illegally manufacturing products or preparing anything for sale on the market and they are hiding, you alert UNBS, because we know where we are not present, there is a Ugandan somewhere, and this Ugandan is a consumer.
Chirabo cautions the public to be vigilant on UNBS staff who solicit money from them without using the right channels.
And don't allow to pay anyone cash, because that is not how UNBS works. Yes. Everything that you have to, if you want a service, your product to be tested in our laboratories, you'll have to pay through the URA payment system. You pay everything through the bank. You don't give any individual cash.
This is not the first time UCC is switching off the phones in Uganda. The first effort was made in 2013. If such a move is put in action, Uganda will follow its counterparts like Kenya and Tanzania, among other countries in the world.
Do you remember you can know the status of your phone by dialing *#60#, and the number you get in there is what you enter into the UCC website to discover how authentic your mobile device is, or your gadget that includes your laptop or any other smart devices that you use in your day-to-day life. Now, moving on, a number of schools across the country remain closed due to failure to comply with the COVID-19 set standard operating procedures by the Ministry of Health. This has been confirmed by the Ministry of Education officials, who also reported that these schools have now started transferring their students to other schools that were able to meet the required minimum standard operating procedures of the Ministry of Health. Jaliat Namuaya has the details.
Even as schools and institutions were given a green light to officially reopen on the 15th of this month for candidate classes and finalists, hundreds of schools remain closed countrywide. In Kampala alone, close to 100 schools have not yet been opened. The head of communications at Kampala Capital City Authority, Daniel Muhumuza Nwabiyine, said that by the end of last week, out of the 641 schools in Kampala, only 516 schools had been cleared to open, while others were issued an ultimatum of 2 weeks to rectify what they had not yet put in place, so they too could be opened.
We were put on a score, we were inspected, and the rating was made on a score of 100, and the pass mark for these schools was 60%. So for the schools that had 60% and above, were among the 516 that have been given certificates to open. However, we have those schools that had a score of between 50 and 59%. And these ones are to be inspected. These are about 36. And the rest were below and did not pass, but we have given them an opportunity to raise their score and get to the 60% mark, so that they can be reopened.
All these other factors lead the formation of rainfall or to the increase or decrease of temperature.
Even as he wasn't comfortable mentioning the names of the schools which have not yet been opened, the spokesperson for the Ministry of Education, Patrick Muinda, put the failure of schools to open in time to the financial constraints making it hard for them to put in place the required standard operating procedures, which include having temperature guns, foot-operated hand-washing facilities, and masks for students, among others.
A few schools that indicated their inability to carry on with teaching because of financial constraints. These schools were gracious enough to inform the parents and to inform the authorities so that the children can be placed in other schools in time. And we are very, very thankful that they came out early to communicate that they have various constraints, financial constraints especially, because their income is largely dependent on the resources paid by parents for school fees. And we're happy that we could get this information early so that parents can be advised on how to place their students in other schools that are able to absorb them and also be able to go on with the different SOPs that are put in schools.
The good news, however, is that the majority of the schools complied and have been issued with the operation certificates.
The schools that have received children are following the standard operating procedures, and we are so far pleased with what we see in the schools. There are schools that had not yet been inspected by 15, that was in Kampala area and Wakiso area, but we'd like to report that these schools have now been inspected and many of them have been given certificates to allow them to open and to receive the candidate classes.
On a visit to some of these schools, we found out that lessons were going on smoothly.
We managed to put all the SOPs that were required for a school to open, whereby we bought the temperature gun, we have it at the gate. We managed to buy all the hand washing materials. As you can see, in our school compound, the sanitizers in all the classes and also in the offices. In the dormitories, also we have sanitizers there and hand washing materials at the entrance. We also managed to have screening of these children at the hotel. We're screening one by one and making sure each child has a mask and also has the requirements for the school.
We thought that it will be a dead year, but that's why we are thanking God, because we managed to come back. And our candidates are really happy because they are back. So we faced some challenges when they said that opening schools, you have to do A, B, C, D, you have to be with a temperature gun, you have to be with a sanitizer, the washing facilities for the children to wash their hands, and you have to be with more than five because of the number of the children you have.
School head teachers, however, disclosed that the turn-up of students is still poor. For example, at Step by Step Primary School in Nansana, out of the 40 Primary 7 candidates, only 30 have showed up. And even though the school has opened, it's still facing financial constraints.
We have challenges. We have faced the challenges coming back. Parents, they have not been working. So we came back when these children, they don't have money. And when we have to use that small amount we have got to see that the school goes on. So we are begging the government to see that such the prices of the things we are using to be a little bit lower. To be a little bit lower, such that we can manage everything and we learn the school to go on.
Part is that since the lockdown was quite long, some of our parents were not able to fulfill the requirements. Two, others also not able to buy for their children what? Masks. The other issue is that some of our children are taken long without studying. The materials that were provided by the government, some of them did not get. So we found a challenge that many of them have not been studied.
Teachers and students went ahead and shared their experience about the new norm of wearing face masks in classes. The majority of these pointed out the discomfort of teaching while wearing a mask, arguing that covering the lower half of the face reduces their ability to communicate. They are now advocating for a subsidized cost of the face shields so they can cheaply acquire them.
Putting on masks isn't too difficult, but we have to put it on because this disease which has come can kill, so we have to force ourselves to wear it. Yeah.
You can't speak well when you are wearing a mask. Sometimes the teacher can't hear you and you can't hear the teacher. So that's the difficulty, I can't say.
These masks, sometimes they itch us because we are not used to them. So we were asking that they may at least give us the face shield so that we may be able to speak very well and to hear our teachers, because it is very hard.
Masks themselves, the children don't hear properly when you are talking, when you are putting on the masks. And also when you ask the children the questions, they don't answer properly. You rarely hear them when they are answering. So every time you are repeating again, or something like that. So that's a major problem. And we have been advised that we put on the other glasses, sort of masks, you know. And the other glasses is expensive. It would be better if our government does something for us and they help us. They provide us with some of these things.
The Minister of Education, however, insists that masks are a must at schools, reminding school operators to diligently implement actions to slow the spread of COVID-19 inside the schools and out in the community. Vigilance to these actions will moderate the risk of in-school transmissions, regardless of the underlying community burden.
That first of all, the children and the teachers observe all the SOPs, that they are very keen on ensuring that they wash their hands frequently whenever they touch surfaces with water and soap, and that they maintain a safe social distance, a social distance as stipulated in the SOPs, to ensure that we together with you fight this COVID-19 and ensure that teaching and learning continues uninterrupted.
Thank you, Jaliet. We do hope that all the schools that were unable to open and are right there struggling can be able to put everything together and have to start being operational to cater for all these other students that are still at home. We'll take a break. When we return, we head to China and see the situation there and how their COVID pandemic is being handled. Do stay with us.